Hey friends, today I wanted to dive a little bit deeper. I've been having fun sharing more about my business journey and what it's been like for me, what I wish I would have known, what I would share with anyone else. And I've been getting lots of replies and questions from people who have ideas that they want to try or potential routes they want to go for, but they're not sure about. And so I just thought today it'd be fun to dive deeper into this side hustle. Like if you have this inkling idea of something that you would want to do that's maybe outside of your day-to-day or your day job, I thought it would be really fun to break down, if I had to name like the steps involved, what they would be to bring a side hustle into the world and how to do it in a way where it's more than just a hobby, right? Like it's not just a passion project you work on for fun, but it's actually something that can start to build a side income and actually start to give you an opportunity to either make more, to have more experiences or more savings or investments, or maybe even one day pivot and be working full-time on something that you love. I mean, both are awesome paths, and you may just have different ideas of what you want, so this will apply to any of those. Okay, and so the first step that I would say to build a side hustle is you've got to find the thing that speaks to you. Like, what is the thing that you want to do? And if you're like, okay, I'm really open to anything, but I don't know what that thing would be, what I would do first is just start to look at the things that you like to do in your free time. So what do you read about when you get home from work? Like, what do you do on the weekends? Is there anything that your friends offer to pay you for or ask you for help in? So maybe you're really good at home organization, and whenever someone has a room that they need to declutter, they call you and you have a bottle of wine together and you go through and you organize everything. Like, that is something you could potentially turn into a side hustle. Maybe for you, you're always reading health books in the evenings. I know that was my journey, and that's why I became so interested in health and nutrition as my first business. And so for you, that could be a potential side hustle route. Maybe you are an amazing cook, or you love to bake, and so you're always making things for your kids' school programs, or you love to have people over and they tell you how amazing your sauces are and you should bottle those up. Like, those are all ideas I would watch for that could potentially turn into a side hustle. So you kind of want to watch for those things that you really enjoy doing in your spare time, right? Because you've always got a job, or you always already got things you're working on. What do you do in your free time? What do you like look up on your lunch break? Or the things that people are always telling you that you should start a business with this thing. A lot of times people will say the things before we even realize it for ourselves, because they don't have that same level of pressure attached to it. So they might see something in you that you haven't yet seen in yourself. So if there's always something that people are saying you should do, or you're really good at this, or you just feel like you have an uncanny ability or memory for, that would be, I would say, all telltale signs that like that could be your potential side hustle. It could also be an industry that you're interested in. So for example, for something like copywriting, what I'll find with my writers or other writers I talk to is it might not be like writing in particular that they ever realized they were passionate about until they started writing for an industry or about a brand or something that they loved. So maybe for you, it's like you could have this side hustle be something like copywriting or editing or whatever, and you're not necessarily like a writer per se, but you love to write when you are learning about and researching and writing about something that you love. You love to share about the industries that you're passionate about. So that's another way to think about it too, is like either come at it directly with like a skill that you have, or just think about the industries that you want to be a part of, and we can find a skill that matches those. And that's been even a big thing for me with copywriting is, for me, it's like I do love to write, but I like to write about certain things, and it has to be things that I'm like really interested in, like health, like personal development, like the stuff on this podcast, for me to be like, I love writing all day. And if it's something else, like maybe there's an industry I don't know as much about, like cars or mechanics or something like that, I'm sure I could write about it, but it's not gonna like make my day fly by. So that's just a nuance to be aware of there, is there's a lot of different ways to come into this. So just kind of be open to all of those. The next piece that I would say is you want to make sure that this is something that there's a market for. So there are a lot of different hobbies you could have, passions you could have, that may be just better suited to be passions. So you want to kind of look and see, like, is this something that there is a market for? And the caveat there is there's a market for almost anything. Like, you really can probably sell almost anything, or these days with the internet, like, find something online for it. But it might make you feel better to start kind of testing and feeling out the market. So, like, one thing that I coach, you know, beginning writers on is, if you're nervous about investing in something, if you're nervous about spending money, like, go into a Facebook group for marketers or for brands and just put a very friendly post in there. Say, hey, I'm thinking about starting this business. I wanted to see if you have a need or what kinds of things that you are interested in or looking for. I'm not going to sell you anything. I'm literally just gathering information at this point. And something like that is so disarming and easy to help, because people know they're not going to be sold to, and they get excited about someone who's starting to launch their dream. So that can be a way to go in and just feel out, like, what are the responses that you get? Like, is there a market for this thing? And that can, one, like, be very good information for you, right? Like, if everyone is interested, then you're like, okay, I'm onto something here. And two, it can give you that confidence that sometimes in the beginning is so hard to feel around your own product or service. So that's kind of one way that I would do it. And it doesn't have to be Facebook groups. I mean, you can go on other job sites or Google things and just kind of see, like, are there other websites out there for this thing? Are there other courses out there for this thing? Are there podcasts about this? Because all those are going to give you some gauge of how much interest that there is, how many people are talking about it. You can look up accounts on Instagram and see what their followings are and what the comments are. So there's a lot of ways to kind of feel out what your industry is like and what the demand is, whether you are interested in photography or environmental conservation or interior design, like anything. I'm trying to think of every industry that you might be interested in, right? And so there's stuff out there for all of those. That is the beauty of having such a connected social world. So your social media habits don't even have to be for just entertainment and scrolling at this point. You can really use them as business tools, like a lot of online business owners do, and go and see what your audience is into, how big the audience is, what they're talking about, what they're asking for, and use that to guide and reinforce or determine kind of where you go next with your side hustle. Okay, so step one is start thinking about the things that really call to you, that you're really interested in. And then step two is to kind of feel out the market, like, make sure there's some kind of market or some kind of interest there before you go and invest in a ton of resources in that arena, right? Okay, so let's say you have got your interest, you feel confident that people are excited about this thing, that there's going to be people who want to buy and work with you. What you can do then is start to get some work samples. And this can be across whatever industry or side hustle you're in, but you want to be able to, once you start approaching people, to have some samples that you can show them. And at this stage, you don't have to get super bougie and super fancy. You really don't. Like, you don't have to invest thousands of dollars or even hundreds into a website. Like, you don't have to go and hire a branding team or a logo designer or anything like that. I mean, I would say that's even not a mistake that I made, but something that I did early on in my business that I didn't need to put that much focus on. Like, I didn't need to have this professional logo right out of the gate. I didn't need a lot of that stuff that made me feel really good and professional, but really wasn't bringing clients in, you know? So I would almost take it a step back and be like, what can I do here? Like, what work sample could I produce that I could email to someone? And so maybe it's a $15 Squarespace website. Maybe it is a free PDF that you package up. I did that for years and years with my portfolio of my marketing and copywriting samples. I just made a PDF. I made it as pretty as I could, added photos. I, you know, formatted the text cute, but that didn't cost me anything except my time. So that's another way to put together your samples. And if you're like someone who does the home organization, like that example we were talking about, I mean, obviously you're not going to have samples of blog posts you've written like I did, but you could have pictures of rooms, like the before and afters that you've done. Obviously with photography or art, you could put together a beautiful portfolio showing your work. You know, if you do like lawn care and lawn services, like put some pictures in there. If you are not super designy, you don't even have to have a full PDF portfolio. That might even be a step beyond and overwhelm you. But just have things that you can send. So at the very basic level, even with copywriting, like I will tell my, you know, students that I mentor is just get some really polished Google Docs together, you know, like make them look good, make them all have the same headlines and fonts, and then you can email those to people. I've done that too. Like you do not have to get super fancy. You just want to make sure that whatever you do, it looks professional, it looks well thought out, well edited, and that is going to show that you have a strong level of care for your craft, even if you don't have all the bells and whistles. People are still going to sense that you really put thought into whatever you delivered, and that will convey, you know, your work and your attention to detail and all the things that people will look for when they want to work with someone. Okay, and so that would be like the first thing is kind of get your samples all together, whatever your industry is. Because the next part is kind of the most scary and exciting part, and it's actually like getting your first clients. So again, so many people invest in all the things before getting clients because I think on some level it just feels better. It's like you're not actually putting yourself out there yet if you're working behind the scenes on getting your website copy just right or on putting together your portfolio. So you may even want to make a date for this, like maybe set a date for each phase, and maybe phase one, it, you know, for 2 weeks, you really explore your interests and you make lists of the things that are really compelling to you and or that people tell you you're really good at. You know, maybe for 2 weeks later, you test your market and you go in those Facebook groups or those online websites or blogs or social media sites, and you just see what the responses and interest is around it. And then maybe for the next 2 weeks, you invest in making like your samples and you get those really polished so you're feeling so good about them. And then after that, you've had plenty of time for each of those things, whatever window of time you use, then it's time to get clients. And I think what's great about that is it gives you the spaciousness and for each of the stages, but it also gives you a plan. Like it also gives you a timeline with a little bit of a fire under your booty so that you don't just stay in that perfecting your samples or market research stage forever. Because to know if something is really viable, you're gonna need to have people actually paying and wanting to invest in you and your services. And so that's where this next stage comes in. And what you wanna do to get clients then, I mean, there's a million ways you can put yourself in front of people, but you can go on event networking sites like Meetup or Eventbrite and see if there's any local events or online events that you could attend. You can go and reach out in those Facebook groups and you can start to post examples of your work now. And you can even follow up and say, I was in here a few weeks ago and you gave me such great feedback. Thank you, everyone. I wanted to share that I'm launching my business or my side hustle, and here's some examples of my work. And you would be surprised how many people can comment then and say, wow, I love it. I would, you know, they're connected to you because they've already weighed in and now you've made them feel like they've helped you build your business, which they have. And so you'd be surprised how many people you might start to get from something like that. You can ask your network for referrals. Like you can email 25 people that you know and say, hey, I'm starting this thing. I'm really nervous about it, but I'm really excited. Or maybe you won't be nervous. I always get a little nervous, so I don't want to project there. But, you know, email your network and say, this is what I'm doing. I'm super excited. I would be so thrilled if you shared this with anyone you know who might be interested. And I just think that in general, people are so excited to see someone else go after their dreams and to chase something and to be bold and brave that they're very excited to help. And everyone knows someone who's looking for something, right? Especially in these areas that other people have already told you you're good at. So I think don't be afraid there to like really lean on your network and lean on other people. And people love to help each other. It makes people feel good to be givers. And so just rely on that. Like imagine how you'd feel if someone was offering a great service and you knew someone who was the perfect fit. So there's so many ways to get in front of people that are creative, and you can even go on online websites for what you're interested in. You can, you know, start a social media following or account and start to post regularly so people get to know what you're doing. Again, don't hide behind the social media. You want to be able to take some really like active steps towards directly interfacing with people and getting clients. And not hide behind that social media, which can be another little trap to stay behind. But I think those are all solid ways to just start building. And the great part about a side hustle is if you already have something else you're doing, it's okay that it takes time. Like, it's okay that it goes slow. And I think one of the mistakes I made in, you know, earlier stages of business is wanting things to always grow faster than they were. And in reality, you want those first kind of trickles of clients because you're going to learn things right away that work or that don't. And you're going to learn where there's gaps in your process, where you maybe have some tech to set up, or you get overwhelmed with, client invoicing, or maybe there's more work than you thought, or you didn't bill accordingly for the amount of time it takes. So there's just so many things that you don't know until you get into it. That it's not necessarily a good thing to get 100 people responding right away. Like if you're baking cookies and 100 people sign up, you might be like in that kitchen all the time all of a sudden. And so there's something sweet and special about even celebrating those first one or two people, finding out what works, and then going and getting a few more, finding out what works or what doesn't, and then keep iterating from there. And that's really the way that a built business or a side hustle can be built. I think a big part of this is just celebrating that at every stage. Every stage has its place and its sweetness, and just enjoying that, I think, goes such a long way. Like, celebrating is one of the big things that I've learned in my life the past few years, of just celebrate every little win, and you'll start to get into that feeling of celebration, which I think begets more things to celebrate because you're feeling better and you're starting to look for those things more because it's fun to celebrate more. And so it's just a little, like, it's not a concrete step, right? But it kind of is. It's still an important one. So kind of play with that too and just really congratulate yourself for doing something that not everyone is brave enough to try or not everyone wants to do, but you do. And if it's on your heart, like, good for you for going after it and just trying. Like, there's so much magic in just trying. And once Sarah Blakely, I probably mentioned this on the podcast before, but Sarah Blakely, who's the founder of Spanx, you know, this massive company for hosiery and underwear, that kind of thing, you know, the Spanx leggings, all the stuff that sucks you in. And she said that every day at the dinner table, her father would ask, "Sarah, what did you fail at today?" And it wasn't a mean question. It was meant to get her to start trying things and being comfortable with failing, because at least she was putting herself out there and being brave enough to try. And so sometimes you have to be gentle with yourself in that own way and be that person for yourself who says, even if it fails at first, even if you get a ton of data on what doesn't work, like, that's still pretty amazing and that's still forward progress. So that's my little pep talk for today, and I hope these ideas are helpful. Remember, it's to, one, clarify your idea, clarify what you love, what other people ask you for or tell you you're amazing at that you really would love to explore more. Number two, test it out, see what the interest is like, feel it out, because at the end of the day, you don't want to be doing this for free unless it's truly just something you do for free, so you want to make sure you'll have buyers. Number three, I would say, is to get those work samples in place so that as soon as number four comes and you start talking to people, you have something to show them and you look like a professional and you look like an expert. And then all the other little bonus steps were like, celebrate, congratulate yourself, know that you're not failing, even if it doesn't work the way you think it will at the start. But all those things are just as important as the first few steps. So I hope that this gets you really excited. I want you to message me, tell me what your side hustle is going to be so I can be one of your first supporters. And thank you so much for being here. I will be back again soon with some more fun ideas for creating your biggest, brightest life, whatever that looks like for you.